Hey, this is Overpass Insights. My name is Eric and I make apps. And today we're gonna play around with Dialogflow. Now, if you've been watching this channel for a while, you may have heard me say that I am very interested in voice applications. So applications for the Amazon Echo, for the Google Assistant, for Siri, for Cortana, you know, that kind of stuff. And we've had a few clients come to us who needed voice activation in their applications, and that got me a bit interested in it. Now, as an indie developer, I haven't really found a good way to monetize it, so it's not something we've gone fully into besides a bit of client work, but as a technical person and for our clients, it's something that I've been really interested in. In fact, earlier this year, I released my first Google Assistant application on the Google Actions or on Google Actions Store. It's really simple. It doesn't do a whole lot, but if you go to Google Assistant and you say, you know, hey Google, talk to Overpass apps, it will connect to Overpass
Let's
apps, it'll play a little MP3 file.
Apps.
Hey, this is Eric from Overpass. Now allow me to introduce you to our Overpass bot.
I am the app bot. Cuckoo ka-choo. How can we help? If you are not sure what to ask, just ask for help.
Exit.
Okay, feel free to visit us again anytime.
Dude, it's like really simple. All it does is it gives you like a random app idea and then it will give you some keyword suggestions just using this this third-party API that we were connecting to, right? It does very little, but I wanted to see how the whole process worked. And I did find it difficult working with a VUI. So you got the two things. You got a GUI, which we're all used to, graphical user interface. We have buttons, we have form fields, we're able to control the user experience and we're able to control everything our user sees. And then we have the voice user interface, which they can ask this application anything. Now it only knows how to answer two things, but it is something to think about. In fact, when I released it to Google Actions, they kept sending it back and rejecting it because I had to do other things to keep the conversation flow going. If the microphone's gonna be left open, it has to be able to say things like, what is your next step? You know, that kind of stuff. So it was a completely different work experience. But being one of the early adopters of Google Assistant, they did send this t-shirt, which I thought was kind of cool. That's why I'm wearing it today. But what I wanted to do today was talk about the general architecture of using tools like Dialogflow to create these kind of interfaces, because it's, as a technical person, if you're a software developer, even if you're an indie developer and you're not interested, I kind of understand that. But it is kind of cool from a technical point of view, and it's surprisingly easy to do, at least to get off the ground. In fact, there's been a few clients where we've sent them proposals, and I just did a quick Dialogflow example or a quick Google Actions example, demonstrating them with a speaker. Like, and I set it up in like 10 minutes, and they're like really impressed because it just looks like science fiction to them. So I want to go through how that works and how it all fits together today, right? And it's a generic overview, but hopefully it's a jumping off point for those of you guys who haven't thought about doing voice to get into it. Now, Gary Vaynerchuk, I think, says that voice is the future. And I'm not quite sure I agree with that, because I think in some ways, voice is much more inferior to a graphical user interface, to a GUI. But, you know, it might take off at some point. And if it does, as software developers, we should probably be ready for it. And the tools that Google are putting out and even the Alexa Skills Kit are surprisingly simple to use. So today I'm not gonna focus so much on Alexa. I'm gonna do the Google, shut up. Sorry, I keep setting off the speaker. I'm gonna focus on Google today and we're gonna use Dialogflow. So when I first got started, I thought Dialogflow was the same as Google Actions, but it's not. It's entirely separate. It's more of a back-end engine. So at the top you have Google Actions, which handles the, you know, okay, Google. When you say that kind of stuff, it listens all the time, and then that gets translated to Dialogflow. And what that Dialogflow will do is process the natural language. So if you say something like, I need your help, or please help me, or I need some help, that will figure out what it is you're trying to say based on the training that you give it. So, and the nice thing about it is you can plug it into other things. So have a look at my screen here. You can see this diagram that I put together. So Google Actions here at the center is what we think about a lot when we talk about doing a Google Assistant. It goes through Google Actions and basically that hands it off to Dialogflow. Now you don't necessarily need to have Dialogflow in the background, but it does really help. So And because of that, as you're putting all that logic in place, that machine learning logic, all pretty much controlled by Google, you can have that go either to your Node.js backend, so if you have some fulfillment there, and connect to a database or another API or whatever. But because you put all that in place, you can create a Facebook Messenger chatbot, you can connect it to Siri, you can connect it to Cortana, you can have an SMS chatbot, or even a telephone answering service using something like Twilio, which is really cool. Now, what it doesn't do is support Alexa. And it does a little bit where you can export the objects to Alexa, but what I've been doing with our Alexa work is we just create a second instance where we use Alexa Skills Network and ask, and it connects to the same Node.js service with a different listener. So let's really quickly go through the dialogue interface so you can see what it does and how it works. So here's an example of the Dialogflow interface. This handles all the incoming intents, so it listens for certain things, it can answer these types of questions. It has entities, which are variables, it has a knowledge base, it has fulfillment. We're gonna go through each one of these ones step by step. But the first part and the most important part is intents. So we have a few different things, like we have like two intents on this Google application. So we've got, give me an app idea. So if we have a look at this, basically, we've added this in app idea, and you can ask certain things. So it listens for certain things, so it knows what to say. Like, what kind of app should I make? Give me an app idea. Can you give me some app ideas? Tell me an app idea, that kind of stuff. Right, and basically what it does is it goes to a Node.js service and it will just randomly generate an app idea using a few different variables. Really simple, child's play type of stuff. Not like, it's not a very technical application, right? So you go there, give me an app idea, and then it will give you a response back. So we can either add responses here, so we can say your app idea is this, or we can say we can send it to a webhook, so which is set up in Node.js, which is what we're doing. So we also have other ones here. Let's go back to intents. So give me some keyword suggestions. So if I say I need some keyword suggestions for the word football on iOS, or give me search terms, or I need search terms. This is another situation where it's listening for that saying. If you want keywords, if you ask for keywords, it will go to that. And on this one, we actually have parameters. So this is called slot filling. So my web service requires, if you want keywords, it requires a seed keyword, which platform you're going to, and possibly how many keywords that you want to know. Now that part doesn't work so well. So what we can do is set up these different parameters, and it will keep asking because it's a required parameter if it needs it. So let's go into the Google Assistant here so we can have a look and you could see what it is. And this is what we talk about goes to Google Actions. So it's loading. So here we go. So we can go into the simulator here and I can say talk to Overpass apps.
All right, here's the test version of Overpass apps.
Right. Give me keyword suggestions.
What is the seed keyword you are using?
So because I'm not given the seed keyword, it's asking for it. Say, let's say pineapple.
For the Apple App Store or Google Play.
App Store or iOS, so we'll take iOS, App Store, whatever. So I've set all these
suggestions for the keyword pineapple on App Store.
So games, friends, play, screen. You know, so this is the type of stuff that it's doing.
Friends, play.
Let's go back to Dialogflow here.
Onido, you want anything else? If you are not sure, just say
actually,
or exit.
The nice thing about this is that depending on how you ask a question, so what I could do when you're testing it on the speaker, I could say, give me keywords for baseball on iOS, right? And then it doesn't have to ask a follow-up question. So it'll just continue to ask the different questions based on what you're doing. And that's called slot filling, which is probably one of the most interesting parts of Dialogflow.
Game, team, app.
So to give you an example here, if you were going to have something that was going to do something for your clients,
to leave me.
if you're going to do something for your clients where they needed to set an appointment. If you watch the Google I/O from last year, they talked about setting an appointment. So it could go through and say there are certain things you're going to need for that function. You're going to need what time is the appointment going to be, what day, what service do you want, et cetera, et cetera. And this is all part of intents. And when you're setting up intents, you're trying to predict what people are going to ask for when they're doing the dialogue flow. Now, when I released this to Google Actions, when I tried to put it to production, they rejected it initially because I didn't have like a menu function, like a help. So what we had to do in order to get it approved, and we went through a few iterations, was have a help option here. So if you say, tell us what you want to do, what does this do, what can I do, etc., etc., and then we have a text response here. So we don't actually go to the web service for that using a hook. So that's how that goes. And the other thing we have is entities. Now you saw there when I said, what platform do you want to use, iOS or Android? Here we could say App Store or Google Play, but then they might also say App Store, iOS, iPhone, iTunes, iTunes Connect. So trying to predict the type of stuff that they were gonna respond to, because we don't have a drop down, we don't have radio buttons. They're gonna say something and we're hoping that it corresponds with one of those things. So that's kind of how all that works together. So with intents and entities, you could pretty much do anything. And then once you have all that data, then it can send it off to your Node.js service. So let me just show you that Node.js service real quick. So this is like a simple function that we have using Dialogflow Firebase Fulfillment. It gets passed onto this using webhooks. Again, if it was simple, we could still do it within Dialogflow. You saw that text response. We could go through and do it that way. But through this one, we could just say, okay, we want to respond with it. We want to send a card. We want to have that. And we could test it going through back and forth what we're going to have to go through. Let's go back to Dialogflow. So even if you were just to play around with that, that would be really, it's really a lot of fun to do, and it handles a lot of that processing. You could have a chat bot. So if you were going to have something for your business or for your client's business, they can have a chat bot that answers all of their questions. You can have that same chat bot going through Facebook Messenger. You can have it going through Google Actions. You could not necessarily have it go through the Amazon Echo, but you can have it go through Siri or Cortana, etc. So you could also have a knowledge base. Now this is one where you can either upload a CSV file with questions and answers, or point it to a web page which has a knowledge base on a website. For me, I've tried both ways and I haven't been able to get it to work. And I don't know, it just seemed to crash on me whenever I started to do it, so I disabled that. But it's still in beta and it's still kind of working. Fulfillment is how you actually do that. So you could fulfill it with a Node.js service on Heroku or whatever server, as long as you have the right libraries in place. Or you can use Firebase. So right now I'm using Firebase Cloud Functions to go through. It's just easier to do it that way. Or you can just have it go straight through the inline editor. And then the integrations. And this is what we talk about, all the different things that Dialogflow can plug into. You saw that diagram I did just a few minutes ago, but you can have it go through onto a website, you can have it go to Facebook Messenger, you can have a phone gateway, which is still in beta, you can have a Slack chatbot, you have it go through Twilio IP, so you can do phone type of stuff, you can do text messaging, Telegram, Skype, Line, but notice down Cortana, but notice down here Alexa. It does have Alexa support, but all it does is it takes the objects that you set up in entities and intents and exports them as XML, which you can import into Alexa, into the Amazon Echo, to the Amazon Skill Kit, the Ask, right? You could import it into that and then write your own backend for that. Right, so if I show you this code over here, we have this Dialogflow Firebase Fulfillment, which accepts all calls through the webhook through there, but also we have the parallel Amazon Alexa skill, which receives from there too. So we have two different interfaces in. That way we can use the same backend Node.js, the same logic and everything like that, going through through two different ways, right? And then finally you've got training, you've got history, you've got analytics. Now this is really, once you release something to go live, this is where you start to see what people are asking and how it's responding to that. So once we put this live, I started to see that people were asking things that were like nothing to do with what the app would do. I was surprised people were even using it to begin with, but this is like, it's like having web logs. Like you can start to see what people are actually looking at, what they're asking, because then that's when you can start building up on the service and seeing what people are asking. So here, you know, Google Assistant, welcome, what is this? We've got, what is this? And you can actually see the interactions of what they're actually doing here. So, and you've got the analytics, how often it's being used, and then you've also got these pre-built agents. Now, there is one thing where Dialogflow API recently went from version 1 to version 2, and a lot of these pre-built agents are in version 1, so we weren't able to use a lot of them, but it's a really good way to learn how this stuff works. And then you've got Smalltalk, which is also kind of fun. So, when we were doing this initially, my kids were trying to ask different questions, but you could have stuff like, if we enable this and I say, let's say hello and goodbye. So if you say good evening, we could say yo mama, right? So if we're gonna do that, let's save this. Let's test it out on Google Assistant. Now, because it's using my dev account, I can still do it with the I can still do it with the speaker, but I'll just do it through the device here. Here we go. Talk to Overpass Apps. Here we go. Talk to Overpass Apps.
All right, let's get the test version of Overpass Apps.
So if I say good evening.
Yo mama.
Yo mama, right? So it's just being able to go through and you can answer all those small talk questions and make it a bit funny and everything like that. So it really is, as you can see, there was no coding I did there with the exception of the Node.js. It was. So it's something as a software developer, something in your skill kit that you may want to look into. It's not difficult. It's not very intimidating to get into to learn how to do these kinds of things. You have all the documentation, everything. It's really when you want to get something difficult. Like if you want to just have straight question and answers, you can do everything within Dialogflow. If you want to have communicating with backend APIs and you know, updating a CRM or whatever, then you use the Node.js or other web hooks that you write, which will respond to that. So this is this is not a very in-depth tutorial. I really want to just go through this. So for those of you who are new to this and haven't even played around with Dialogflow or any of these type of things and may not even know what it's capable of doing, it's something that I think you should probably look into because it's a lot of fun to play with. So anyway, that is it for today. Thanks very much for watching this new format of the channel. We're gonna, the tutorials I don't think we're gonna do too much of. You know, it's not that much fun really, is it? So anyway, but that is it for today. I'll talk to you guys again later on in the week.